John Rubenstein.
Where
How about that? How about that for an introduction? John Rubenstein, crazy like a fox.
Had a rough day, huh?
Did you have a rough day or did I have a rough day?
I'm asking you if you did.
No, I've had a wonderful day, and now it's even more wonderful now that you're here.
Oh, thank you.
I found out that his father was Arthur Rubenstein, the famous concert. Now, you've got to tell us how to pronounce it. Is it pianist, or pianist?
Well, no, it's pianist because he plays a piano. You don't play a piano.
Many people, you know, how about flute? A person who plays a flute is a what?
You're allowed to say flutist. The actual technical term is flautist, but that's really, flaute is a German word for flute. There just doesn't happen to be an English word, flutist.
So, flutist.
Flutist, I say, in spite of all those who insist on saying flautist.
Yeah. You play the piano too. I know you do a lot of scoring
for that.
Yes. Who insisted that you learn to play the piano? Was it Mama or was it Papa?
Well, it was both. It was both. It was sort of a foregone conclusion that I would play, and my sisters and brother would play, and we did.
What age were you?
Four.
Four. Did they force you? I mean, did they say, John, you've got to do that? And did you resist it, or did you just said?
I didn't resist playing. I loved playing. I resisted practicing all my life to the degree where I'm now an actor.
The curious thing is that even though you do both your music and the acting, you're really doing more acting than you're doing music.
Well, at present I am. Well, because a television series goes on and on and on if it's successful, and you work 12, 14 hours a day every week, and it just goes on and on and on.
How is Jack Warden's health?
Fine. He's strong.
Because I know it's rather rigorous. Some of the scenes that you do are rather rigorous, and I thought, do they need a stuntman to bring in a stuntman for Jack Warden?
They bring a stuntman for me.
For you.
Kidding?
Warden's doing fine.
He's fine. No. There are great professionals in this business called stuntmen and stunt drivers, and particularly for a show like ours, who do tricks with cars. I mean, you see them, you take them for granted every week, but boy, would you like to be in a car and do that even for money? Mm. I wouldn't. And they have guys, Stag Summers is the name of the man who doubles for me, and Jerry Summers is his father, who is our stunt coordinator. And they do miracles. And it's always me if it's something that you think you could survive, jumping, falling, running very fast. You know, that's always me. In the car, it's almost never me.
Yeah. Do you know what he's done in his trailer? Brought in a piano. Had a piano brought into your trailer.
Yes.
And you're practicing, you're scoring Orphan Train?
Well, yes, that's on the shelf now, but I have been writing the music for Orphan Train, a Broadway musical, in my dressing room while shooting, yeah.
Do you know that there were a number of people in Nebraska who were on that
train? Oh, I know. It wasn't just the one train, you know, it went on for years and years and years. We were writing a musical about the very first train that went out. Fascinating thing, and it had a lot to do with bringing the new immigrants from the east out west to settle. Mm-hmm.
You know, I saw you do Children of a Lesser God on Broadway. That was so moving.
Yeah, great play.
Did you have to learn all the hand signals and work with people who were deaf? How did you?
Well, my leading lady was deaf, and the other two hearing impaired people in the cast were also truly hearing impaired. And it was a situation where my leading lady, Phyllis Frelick, didn't speak either. So she signed all of her lines, and then I would repeat her words as she signed them, and then I would speak to her out loud for the audience and sign to her simultaneously. So essentially, I spoke the whole play, other than the lines spoken by the other characters.
How long did it take you to prepare, to get ready to do that kind of thing, to learn?
3 weeks.
Only 3 weeks?
That's all I had. The audience was there after 3 weeks. Yeah. It was here in Los Angeles. We did it at the Mark Taper Forum, and the writer, Mark Medoff, was writing the play while Gordon Davidson was directing it, and Phyllis and I and the rest of the cast were rehearsing it, and after 3 weeks, bang, we were in front of an audience.
Mm-hmm. Crazy Like a Fox has moved to Wednesday nights, and in a way that's a little unfortunate, and I say this because the audience for CBS skews a little older than some of the other networks. And with a terrific lead-in you've had from Murder Like She Wrote, with an older audience primarily, then flowing over into your show. I hate to see it move, John.
Well, I don't know. I have to believe that the people who make those decisions know what they're doing.
Know what they're doing.
And are doing it not to hurt a show, but to help a show. I think our show, which has been doing very strongly in its Sunday night spot, pardon me.
Bless you.
You can edit these things, I hope. Can you?
No. That's acting.
This
let's
is
see
a sick
cough.
Person you're looking at.
Let's see you cough.
I won't cough again. It hurts.
Somebody said you had a cold.
I
and
do.
You're putting up with this long, hard thing.
That's right.
Now, a real true thing. Actor comes through.
No, I'm not acting. I'm sick.
No. Oh, you are. Okay.
No, anyway, what I was saying is I have to trust that those people, the network, you know, executives who make those rules and decisions, know what they're talking about. The competition on the Sunday night 9 p.m. slot is much heavier than the competition on the 8 p.m. slot where Angela Lansbury's show comes. And she has been destroying the competition, I'm glad to say. But then when 9 comes, opposite us are two movies on the other two networks. And every night, every week, they could be a different blockbuster of a movie. So even our regular viewers sometimes will watch one of the movies because they know we'll be there next week. Now CBS is going to put in a movie in our time slot, put us to Wednesdays where we're going to be battling a normal competition every night, every week, the same, and I think we'll kill them.
Good. John has an unfortunate memory of Lincoln, Nebraska, because he hurt his, you fell on the ice in Lincoln and hurt your hip.
It was so cold. It was a February day in 1968, and I arrived there sick. I'm always gone now. From Wichita, and got there to do my show, and I missed the bus, and I ran from the hotel.
What show were you doing?
On a clear day, you can see forever. I think Bill Hayes was doing it.
In Lincoln, you did that in Lincoln?
You bet. 1968.
I saw you in that. I saw that. I didn't realize that was.
Did you see Bill Hayes or Howard Keel or John Raitt? I think you saw Bill Hayes.
Yes.
Yeah.
And you were in that show.
Yes, I was.
That would have been at the Stewart Theater.
Stewart Theater. That's right.
And that was you. My goodness.
About 3 blocks away, there's a hotel.
Come, yes, you probably stayed at the Cornhusker Hotel.
Cornhusker. That's right, because I remember that name. What hotel would be called the Cornhusker?
Well, they raised it, and now we have a brand new Cornhusker. So please come back. The Stewart Theater is still there. We'll do On a Clear Day or Children of a Lesser God. Or a scene from Crazy Like a Fox, and you won't slip on the ice.
No.
And you'll be
I wear cleats.
And you'll be well and healthy, and you won't have a cold, and everything is going to be wonderful, John.
Oh, it sounds so great. Don't let me do this.
No, right now.
Okay.
Pleasure. Good luck with Crazy Like
Thank
a Fox.
You.
Moving here on 10-11 to Wednesday nights. Please, stay with us. We'll be right back as the morning show continues.